You want me to do it here just in case too?
Yeah, just in, yeah, exactly. Just in case
yeah,
it
I'll
like
do it.
Cuts out
Okay.
halfway through. I'll be like, oh shit.
Welcome to the Crooked Table Podcast, where we discuss the world of film from a fresh angle. And now your host, Robert Yannis Jr.
Welcome to the Crooked Table Podcast. This is Rob. This is the show where we talk to fans and critics alike, letting them discuss a film of their choice, whether it's their favorite movie of all time or just something that connects with them emotionally. And we just really even the playing field as far as film criticism goes, bringing fresh voices on every episode. And this episode, we're talking to Michael Hinman, a longtime friend, former coworker, and host of Alpha Waves Radio. How are you doing today, Mike?
I'm doing great. How about you?
Pretty good. Pretty good. It's a pleasure to talk to you. It's your Crooked Table debut, as I recall.
It is. I've been waiting forever to be invited on this show, so thank you for finally doing it.
Well, it's a long list, so, you know, we had to add you to the bottom
it is.
Of it to start with. So, you know, why don't you tell the listeners a little bit about who you are, how we know each other, and what you have going on these days?
Well, I mean, I live in New York City. I actually live in the Bronx, but I spent 20 years in Florida, which is where you are. And we actually met, I think you were interning, if I remember right.
That's correct,
you know. Yeah, back in the day, I was a reporter for the Tampa Bay Business Journal, and you were interning there. And, you know, I don't know what it was, but for some reason, we became friends, and it's like never wavered at all. And, you know, I think a lot of that is because of our love of movies and television and stuff. And, you know, a lot of my journalism career has been in newspaper. It is still right now. But I also ran a science fiction entertainment news website for the longest time that started out as Sci-Fi Portal back in the 90s. Spelled SYFY, and that's no coincidence. I sold that brand name to NBC in 2009, and that became the name of a cable channel that everybody hates even to this day. And you know, home to Sharknado, so you know it was important. You know, and so right now, I about a few months ago, or about a month ago or so, I revived Alpha Waves Radio, which was my podcast that I had in association with my website, which had become Airlock Alpha. And so I was invited to bring it back to Odyssey. I decided to do that. So yeah, you can hear that on Odyssey right now, Tuesday nights at 7 Eastern.
Yeah, and just I should probably mention on the podcast, if you're listening, you could be listening to this in the podcast form. You could be listening to this on Odyssey, odysy1.com, as Mike pointed out. Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. is the Crooked Table on there. So definitely check out that site if you're not already listening to it from there at this moment. But yeah, that's pretty much kind of the lowdown on Mike and our history. And, you know, we worked together since several times in Tampa Bay Business Journal. I did some writing for Airlock Alpha back in the day. And just kind of feels like we're always looking for reasons to have our creative paths kind of intersect. And I think it's really important to me to have, you know, like-minded friends and associates too. We can kind of, you know, promote each other's work and bounce ideas off of each other and things like that. So it's really good
and
to have you on here.
And we've even worked creatively, even though it has never been produced, and that's probably more my fault than anybody else's. But, you know, but you and I worked together pretty closely on a web miniseries that we co-wrote together. And, you know, we were very close to getting it produced, a couple of times. And, you know, and just a lot of that is just, you know, my availability. I think it's like it really hurts things because I don't have a lot of it. But I love that, you know, and I hope that does get produced because I think it's pretty timeless. And I've felt that, you know, that your work on it was brilliant.
Oh, thank you very much. If only one of us was in a major city where there was some kind of, I don't know, creative mecca that they could tap into.
If only.
Well, I like to think at some point that project we'll figure that out and dust it off, because I do think, I mean, I feel like we've gotten universally positive feedback on that. So
maybe it was a labor of love between us. So,
oh yeah, absolutely. You know. And we wrote it relatively fast. I think it was just kind of six episodes, just kind of a week by week, banging it out like within a couple months.
Yeah, you and I were at a restaurant. I think we were eating lunch or something, you know, from work, and you and I developed these characters. Didn't know what we were going to do with them. I think we were just having fun developing characters. Thought about how cool it would be to throw them on a road trip or something. And, you know, and I think it took us a few years to finally get that going, to get that moving. And then once we started developing that story, I think it really came together. And we wrote like these six, 12-minute episodes. Because back then, YouTube was only like 10 minutes or 12 minutes long. So, and you couldn't go beyond that. that. And so we were writing it for YouTube. That's how old the, you know, how long it's been since we actually wrote it. But yeah, but it came together really fast once the ideas really started forming.
Yeah, it's a prime example of life kind of getting in the way, where we have the idea, it sits for a couple of years, we write it, and then it sits for another couple of years, we try and get it made, and then another couple of years.
I think we're almost 8 years now.
Yeah, since. Something like that. That's what I'm saying. So yeah, so hopefully we get back to that. And if anything ever happens with that, at some point we'll have to talk about it on the Crooked Table Podcast. And
that's right.
Get the word out about it. Exactly.
We'll critique it.
There you go. One of us will be like, it's my favorite film. It's my favorite project. But you worked on it. You're not objective. Like, well, you know, it doesn't matter. It still counts. So today we actually are talking about your favorite film that you and I have never really discussed at length, I don't believe. So this should be an interesting conversation. So we're going to listen to a little bit of the audio from today's feature presentation, American Beauty.
We're having everyone write out a job description. That way management can assess who's valuable
and who's expendable.
My parents are trying to take an active interest in me. Why can't they just have their own lives?
I'm so proud of you. You didn't screw up once.
Oh my God. It says psycho next door.
Jane, what if he worships you?
I didn't mean to scare you. I'm not obsessing. I'm just curious.
Why does he dress like a Bible salesman?
Today I quit my job, and then I blackmailed my boss for almost $60,000 past the asparagus.
All right, so that was a little bit of American Beauty. This is, of course, the 1999 film directed by Sam Mendes, written by Alan Ball, starring Kevin Spacey, Annette Bening, and a bunch of character actors, all of whom seem to are still working today. I know now Chris Cooper and Allison Janney both have Oscars, and I kind of forgot Allison Janney was actually in this film until I rewatched it earlier today. And it won Best Picture, Best Actor, Cinematography, like basically 5 Oscars. And it was by far the big winner that year. So I guess we should probably get into what the film is for people that haven't seen it. So I can hand it over to you, Mike. What is, you know, for people that haven't seen American Beauty, what is this film about, and why should they give it a look if they haven't already seen it?
Well, this is kind of I think, you know, it's obviously sensational, obviously fictional, but almost like a deep look into life in suburbia, and not even just like it just basic suburbia, but really it kind of goes deep down into the life and death of one man who, you know, basically was lost in life, who was lost in you know, in what family has done to him and what everything else has done to him, and where one day he decided to just make that change, and you know, and that change set course, this domino effect basically that resulted in his death, which he says at the very beginning. Of course, it's kind of tough because, you know, one of the people who are not mentioned that's in this film is the star of this is Kevin Spacey, who's been, you know, obviously and very rightfully so, kind of blacklisted from everything now. But I try not to judge films based on that. I mean, mm-hmm. So. You know, I still have to look at – I try to look at the overall film, even if it's sometimes kind of difficult to watch that with those types of people in there. But yeah, I mean, it's a very interesting take with Alan Ball writing it. And if people aren't familiar with Alan Ball, this is what the characters and the storytelling format is what was actually used as a template for 6 Feet Under, the hit HBO series that came out right after this,
okay.
Which was also created by Alan Ball. You know, and so you see a lot of parallels in terms of like Allison Janney's character, for instance, and, you know, and some of the other people and the way that they interact with each other. It to me, this is probably, you know, one of the few movies where I felt that the interactions between people were natural.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of that, I think, is coming from, and I think that you see that now in a lot of like comedy shows like Curb Your Enthusiasm or Veep and stuff, where there's a lot of ad-libbing, like where there's a lot of like, here's a situation, now play into it, which kind of helps create that realism as well as the comedy. But you also had a lot of that in American Beauty, which I've also loved, where there's a lot of back and forth banter that's actually ad-libbed that creates a realism, like that, where you almost think that the Burnham family really exists, that they really live in this house with this white house with a red door, that they really have a neighbor you know, who is, you know, like a military guy, retired military guy, his wife who's has some kind of mental issues, and a son who's actually probably the block's biggest drug dealer. And, you know, and it's just, it's absolutely an amazing film.
Yeah. It's a really interesting movie. It's very much a slice of life. And, I guess I didn't 100% realize until recently that it is part of the naturalism does come because a lot of it wasn't necessarily scripted to a T. It was more like, all right, now you two are fighting. These are the underlying issues. Like you said, play into it. I think there was some of that, and you can feel it in some of the scene where he picks up the plate of asparagus and throws it against the wall and things like that. So that's pretty much a good overview of just what the film is about. It's really centers on this family, and just I guess that it really centers on this one street. It's them, and the only other characters are all their neighbors, pretty much. And this kind of focuses on the microcosm of these people's lives and kind of says something much larger by focusing on this one family. So, you know, why you said this was your favorite film, why specifically is that the case? And then what's kind of your history with it? Like, when did you first see American Beauty?
Well, I saw American Beauty on its opening night, in the theaters. I saw a trailer for it. I think I was there to Blair Witch Project. I think I had gone to see the Blair Witch Project, and I remember, like, you know, the two things I kind of remember from that, and I'm hoping that I'm remembering this right, because this is like 20 years ago, but I remember, like, wishing I had taken Dramamine, and because the camera goes all over the place. But I remember seeing this trailer, which was basically, you know, look closer kind of thing, and it just looked totally fascinating. It had Kevin Spacey and Annette Bening in it, and some other actors I didn't recognize at all, and it just looked really, really good. And so I did actually go see it opening night. I was that interested in it. It's funny because this was a film by DreamWorks. And, and one of the things about DreamWorks, especially at that time, was that Steven Spielberg was heavily involved. And Steven Spielberg would personally screen, like, every movie. There's that kind of a story where the writer and the director of the film, you know, visit, you know, Steven Spielberg's office, you know, because they're going to screen the film. Well, by that, he means that they had to sit in the office and wait while Steven Spielberg sat in his personal theater and screened it. And then he would normally come out with a bunch of notes on things to change and everything else. But, you know, at least according to, I think, Alan Ball, that when Steven Spielberg, you know, came out of the theater, he had tears in his eyes. And he said, it's perfect. Don't change a thing. And to be honest, when I watch it, I've seen this movie probably 30 times now.
Wow.
And to me, it's like, it's perfect. It's absolutely, I am so critical of movies and films. I cannot find anywhere in this film that I would change if it was up to me, or that I would think it could have been done differently. And for me, the biggest thing that I really like about this is not just the characters' journeys that we have in this, you know, and everything else, but the fact that it all leads up to something that's unexpected, which, I mean, I kind of call it, because I love twists. I'm a big fan of twists, and I love trying to figure them out, and I love trying to see, like, how those twists were hidden by the writers. And so in a few times that I've done some of my own personal fictional work, I like to incorporate twists and try different methods of putting it in there and making it, giving you a fair shot as the viewer of that or the reader of that to figure it out, but still try to hide it enough to where it still surprises you. And for me, American Beauty has what I call, I don't know what the actual technical term, but I call it a double pump twist. Mm-hmm. Basically where you think, because you know from the very beginning that Kevin Spacey's character is going to die. You don't know how, you don't know why, you don't know by who.
Which is a really ballsy move. Feel like something that hadn't really been done in this, at least not in this scope before. Basically, hey, I'm the main character, but I'm going to be dead very soon.
Yeah.
So don't get too attached.
Yeah, don't get too attached. That's right. And so you're looking through this whole film. It's like, because then the film goes on as if, like, why? How does any of this lead to his death? But then things start coming together, like all these different threads that were just seem to be like loose threads suddenly start coming together into like this very well-woven fabric. And and there's a scene in there, and this can't be spoilers. This is 20 years old. If you haven't seen it by now, there's something wrong with it.
There's no spoilers.
Okay, so
we're going.
But there's
for
a
it.
But you know, but the you know, but the you know, but the military father of the next door neighbor, you know, he's so anti-gay and he's so like afraid that his son is gay, and he thinks that this interactions that his son is having with Kevin Spacey's character is some sort of gay relationship, which you know, it which happens to be like he looks through the out of his window and he sees in the garage and he sees like it's like just in the windows that he can see there's like gaps so he can't really see some of the stuff, but it looks like they're having sex, but in actuality what it is that his son is just rolling a joint, you know, because he's a pot dealer,
right.
So then you have to see after this discovery where there's whole big fear, there's a scene like where you know the father, you know, played by Chris Cooper, shows up, you know, at the garage where Kevin Spacey was in, you know, because he's in there smoking and lifting weights because he's trying to, you know, boink his daughter's friend.
These are all things we'll get into in depth. Yeah,
and so the garage door like opens and it's pouring down rain, and there he is, you know, and you know that he has weapons as also he's an old military guy, and he's just soaked in the rain, and he's like, oh my god, this is the scene where, you know, he's going to get killed, you know, and it has to be. I mean, everything led up to this point, but then it ends up he's not there to shoot him, he's there to kiss him because he thinks that he's gay, and that, you know, and he's so deeply closeted that you know, that he sits there and he kisses him, and then he just walks away when Kevin Spacey rejects him, when Lester Burnham rejects him, he just walks away. And to me that's brilliant, because what happens to us as a viewer, as we're watching this movie, it even happened to me, and I love it. If you can trick me in a twist, you've got me forever. Is that you totally discount him for the rest of the movie. You totally discount that father for the rest of the movie because you have his wife that's after him, his daughter that's after him.
There's a lot of misdirects going on for sure.
Yeah, there's a lot of people who, like, to the point like you don't know who wants to have him dead. And in the end you find out that it actually is the father that does it, you know? And it's great because you totally dismissed him. You really thought that his story was done.
Mm-hmm.
That he did the kiss, got rejected, and he walked away. It didn't even think that maybe he'd come back because now, oh shit, you know, now I've revealed myself, I got to get rid of this guy, you know? So
yeah, or sort of the scorn for you know, the only person he's ever come out to rejecting him, or yeah, it's a combination of the two. I mean, for me, this is only the second time I've seen this film. I saw it once when it came on home video, I guess 2000 or whatever, soon after the awards season had passed, that kind of thing. And I remember being really struck by it. It's one that I've always wanted to go back and revisit, because I did randomly pick it up on DVD at some point along the last 18 years. I just hadn't been able to pick it up because it hit you really hard emotionally. And it's very entertaining, but it's also not like a fun movie. It's actually takes a toll on you. At least it does on me. Like it's really heavy to watch. And you know, because the whole bottom line is the whole thing is kind of the perversion of the American dream kind of gone bad, because, you know, he's got the kid, he's got the house in the suburbs, you know, successful wife, everything appears to be perfect. And I guess that's where the look closer tagline comes in. And I, you know, I just hadn't been able to really go back to it. I was like, I don't really want to put myself through that just now. So when you expressed to me that you wanted to talk about this movie, I was like, all right, this is going to happen. I'm going to go back and watch it, see how it holds up. And I think, you know, watching it now, knowing the twist, and, you know, I had a whole new appreciation for the way that it's set up, the way that they are like multiple red herrings. The very first scene, you see a scene between Wes Bentley's character, Ricky, and Thor Birch's Jane. You know, he's filming her and they're kind of talking about, she's like, oh, my dad sucks, blah blah blah, you know, he's such a lame-o, and he's like, do you want me to kill him for you? And it's like, she's like, yeah, would you? And then it cuts away. It's sort of just planting that little seed of doubt in your head that, hey, maybe these two are sort of behind it.
And you know what's funny about this, Robert, too, is that, you know, is that this film actually had other scenes that were filmed. It was actually written slightly differently. The envelope story for this was supposed to be in a courtroom. They actually filmed courtroom scenes,
really?
To where Jane and her boyfriend were on trial for murder, for Lester's murder. And so, in fact, if you ever watch the DVD, if you ever watch like the interviews and stuff, all the interviews, all the actors are sitting in a courtroom when they're talking. And that's the courtroom that they had filmed in. They were all like, they filmed it in the courtroom. So the whole envelope was supposed to be like this trial where that video was the key piece of evidence. And the scene that you see, like, you know, it was like almost like a drone, even though the drones didn't exist yet, like the drone shot, the aerial shot of the town, of the street. They also actually had Kevin Spacey flying through there, like as if he's a ghost.
Oh, wow.
And they filmed those things, but they ended up cutting those things out because they felt it distracted from the main story. And I think that was the brilliant cut that they did. I mean, to me, even though that it's kind of hard to cut those things when you set up a courtroom and do all these scenes and you cut all that out, I think it's brilliant.
Yeah, I think that it's a really smart move that they scaled that back because you don't need it. Any of that, it's much cleaner and simpler to just like throw that little clip out there in the very beginning, right before he's like, "This is me, this is my life," and mm-hmm. in just less than a year, I'll be dead. I think it's I don't know. I feel like it puts a lot more faith in the audience than here's a conventional setup. This is what you guys need, right? I think it's a much more artistic and classier way of handling the story. And, this film was not only did it win all these awards and get all this acclaim, this was part of 99, which is regularly referred to by like a lot of cinephiles and film critics and stuff as one of the best modern years of film, because you had this and Fight Club and Being John Malkovich and a lot of these really ambitious, The Matrix, which is one of my favorites, a lot of really ambitious, different kind of outsidery stories being told and making it into the mainstream. And I think American Beauty, the fact that it did win Best Picture is really kind of emblematic of what a sort of modern turning point that year was for, what could become a huge box office hit, what could kind of cross over out of the indie circuit and that kind of thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And that's what, and I think that's, that was one of those interesting things too, because it was during that period, I kind of brag, I think like between 1996 and 2003, I think was my streak where I was able to predict the Best Picture winner on opening night of that film. Nice. Cause I went and saw it. It's like, oh, this is Best Picture. And I said it with American Beauty, this is Best Picture, and I was kind of worried that my little show, I think my show was only like 3 years at the time. And I was a little bit worried it was going to end because there was a lot of great competition that year. There were some excellent movies. It was really kind of hard to tell like how that was all going to shake out. Like would this movie, which is so different from what Hollywood normally produces, would this do? And that was back in the day when the Oscars rewarded films for being different, and not just being different, but also being different and innovative, like where they're setting new trends and doing new things, that it's not just a popularity contest. That it was all about technical aspects of it in terms of storytelling and cinematography and everything else. And I think, since Avatar was denied, Avatar didn't have the greatest story in the world, but Avatar set up the whole, what would become the movie, industry for the next 15 years, mm-hmm. with the use of 3D and the way that they used it, with the use of sound and everything else, and the use of CGI, that really hadn't been used to that, to me that's what made that a best picture, not the crappy story. It was that part. It was, and I like the Hurt Locker, but I don't think the Hurt Locker did those things.
Right.
And, that was back, I think, when the Oscars, and that's why I don't have the same opinion of the Oscars as I used to. I used to love Oscar night. That used to be a holiday in my household. Now it's like, oh, the Oscars are on. I guess I'll check it out or I'll record it, and I'll start halfway in and I'll just, skip through all the boring stuff, basically.
catch the highlights on YouTube the next
day. Yeah.
Well, I think that's about it. And that exact reason of what you're saying, rewarding ambition versus like whatever the most popular film is, that's sort of how I felt like that year a couple years ago when we thought La La Land won Best Picture and it turned out that it was Moonlight, because I love both of those films. But to me, La La Land just felt like the safe choice, and Moonlight felt like them kind of making a statement a little more, especially, with everything that was going on in the world, being like, no, we're going to give it to the movie about the, the black gay kid in Miami and like his ordeal and him growing up and kind of coming of age in that regard, rather than, the throwback to old Hollywood musicals. So I think that they still have it in them every once in a while, but it's kind of a case to case basis to see if, which way they're going to go. But I mean, in this case, this was watching it today. I mean, it's hard to watch this film and be like, yeah, this didn't deserve Best Picture. I'm like, no, it's got pretty much everything you would want from that. In addition to the emotion that I mentioned, just like the imagery I noticed throughout the movie, and I guess we're sort of shifting into our review section here now. Just I noticed like throughout the movie, and I remember this very clearly. at the end of the film, I remembered him looking at the picture of his family right as he's about to get shot. And that like really stuck with me about like the contrast of him fondly looking back on the way things were and like how it is now where his family's completely shattered. He has to ask his daughter's friend, like, how is her life? Because she's not telling me anything. And, you know, he kind of reaches sort of a kind of peace in that moment right before. And there's a real focus on the family photos throughout. I mean, early on, you see the camera kind of pans over to the photos of happier times while they're like bickering and this whole toxic family dynamic that they have going on.
And you know, what's really interesting too, the part where you said like where he was asking, where he had to ask his daughter's friend about, you know, about his daughter. What was also very compelling about that scene is that she then, and by the way, and this was right after, you know, he finally had a chance to sleep with her, with his friend, and she was seen to be all for it, but then she said she was a virgin, and he realized, wait a minute, you know, what am I doing? And he stopped. You know, and decided to, you know, do the right thing, which is not sleep with her. Mm-hmm. And so now he's like making her, I think, grilled cheese sandwiches or something. And, you know, and he's asking, yeah, and he's asking about, and that makes me hungry for grilled cheese sandwiches now. Seriously. But like, and he's asking, you know, he's asking about Jane, his daughter. But then she turns around and says, how are you doing? Mm-hmm. And he stops because, and he realizes nobody's asked him that in a long time. Nobody's asked Lester Burnham how he's doing. You know, everybody's judging him. Everybody's trying to manipulate him. Everybody's trying to push him in different ways. But nobody seems to care how Lester Burnham is doing. And I think that to him that was finally – it's like finally, you know, it was like a breakthrough that finally somebody cared to ask.
Yeah. And, you know, that moment, I think in a lot of ways this film is all about appearance versus reality. And I think the fact that he's got this fantasy version of Angela in his head and then realizes in the moment – that, you know, she's a virgin, she's not the sex pot he envisioned her to be, I think it really kind of brings that theme home. And the fact that he turns around and then like turns into dad mode and like puts, you know, like the sweater or whatever over her shoulders and like starts making her food. It was like, oh, you seem probably hungry, let me take care of you, not like nail you like I was trying to do 5 minutes ago. I think that's a really interesting sort of reversal. This seemingly perfect family is like really messed up behind the scenes. And I thought it was interesting too, because the film starts with his perspective and you see like, oh, look at my wife. What a bitch. Look at my daughter. Like, we used to know each other and now, you know, I don't know what happened, that kind of thing. And then it shifts over to his wife's perspective and you see that she's like cleaning the house and like really feeling pressure to cleaning the house that she's trying to sell. She's a real estate agent. I should have established that up front. That she's really under a lot of pressure to sell this. She's got her like repeating to herself, I will sell this house today. It's like a mantra that she's like under her own kind of pressure. You know, that he has one vision of her and her in his mind, but what she's got a whole other mess of things going on her end that she never communicates to him. And I think that's the biggest thing. They sit at dinner and they don't talk. Wes Bentley, Allison Janney, and Chris Cooper, they sit at dinner. They don't really talk. Nobody knows what's going on in each other's lives. Everybody's so isolated and cut off. And I think that's, you know, that's another huge, I guess, commentary that the film is making about like families and relationships. It's like communication. Nobody here is trying to work through everything. Everybody feels like the world is on their shoulders.
You know, and I think another thing too that this kind of helped open up a little bit was the idea that just because somebody on the outside looks like they're doing well, like you see some of these perfect families and you're like, oh wow, you know, why can't our family be more like that? You know, I mean, you know, we live in a society that, you know, as much as I love television and movies, it's also created a society with, you know, unfair expectations or unrealistic expectations. Now we think that people should be a Prince Charming, you know, before we fall in love with them, or that like perfect families, you know, they solve their problems in a half hour, or that, you know, if the police come and investigate something, that they should be able to use their CSI unit with all these great technologies that don't even really exist. And you know, and be able to solve crime, you know, like really quickly, and somehow justice always prevails and stuff. And you know, and I love that this kind of breaks that shell of that, to where yes, you can look like a perfect family on the outside, but until you actually look closer, that you look inside that family or any person or any group, that if you get deep down to it, you know, there probably are issues there, and just it is probably worse that they're not expressing those things, that where absolutely. You know, Lester Burnham has to share those with us through you know through his life flashbacks from right before he dies, that he's sharing that with us, the audience. But these are things that he really couldn't share with his wife. He couldn't share them even with his daughter. I mean, by the time that he tries to figure out what's happening with his daughter, it's not really through his daughter, it's through a surrogate. Mm-hmm. You know that his wife, you know, tries to seek, you know, to seek something in life, to try to find her path, not through her husband, but also through a surrogate, through the king of real estate, you know, and you kind of have all of these, all of these different elements where, you know, you realize like this perfect family is far from perfect.
And I think that, and it's funny because this movie came out before social media and all of that, which now I think that whole appearance versus reality thing is even more separate than ever before, because you can post every, you know, everybody sees things on Facebook and they're like, oh man, why can't I have the perfect life of this person? But there's all this stuff that's being, you know, edited. Like, editing is key to, you know, kind of setting up a public persona, and there's all this stuff that's not being said. And I think that's really what this film kind of gets to the heart of.
Yeah. And, you know, and that's the biggest thing that, you know, and I talk about this quite a bit, as much as I can, if people want to listen to it, is that, you know, and I think in a way, I mean, there's a lot of things that hurt relationships to begin with, but in a way it's that idea of perfection, like where, you know, I need to have somebody who, you know, is that perfect partner, you know, based on what I've seen in fairy tales. It used to be fairy tales that we judged it by, but now, you know, television and movies have become so realistic, but they still kind of put out those, you know, I saw this weekend, I saw The Green Book with Viggo Mortensen and Mahershala Ali, and you know, and I like the concept of it. I like to think, but it was so Hollywoodized.
Mm-hmm. That was my issue with it too.
Yeah, I mean, there was like I really can't wait to see, you know, what actually isn't true about this, which I would want to say is probably about 70%, because I mean, you know, and like the one scene at the end, like they get back in a deep snowstorm, you know, the you know, Viggo gets dropped off in the Bronx in the middle of a snowstorm while Mahershala's character goes back to Carnegie Hall in Manhattan. But then later, even after he gets home and settled, he decides to drive back through the snow to the Bronx. I'm sorry. There's no way that happened.
You're like I'm a New Yorker now.
Even in a rented car, that's just not going to happen. Just a few weeks back, I think when New York City had its first snowstorm, it shut down the whole city. I got stuck in traffic for 6.5 hours. Jeez. So, you know, I was basically living in my car. I felt like it was in a Doctor Who episode. You know, the one where they're stuck on the highway, living in their cars for 30 years, and it's what it kind of felt like. I was wondering if I was going to have to, you know, start, you know. You know, foraging for food or something. But yeah, it's just, I don't like that. I think that, you know, and you see that a lot too, like where I have an issue like when movies take historical things without calling it historical fiction. Like Gladiator is historical fiction. Right. You take real characters and you put them in fictional elements. So, you know, so, and they say that up front that it's fictional. But then you get like I always pick on, I think it was the Johnny Depp film where he played the guy who wrote Peter Pan.
Oh,
was that Finding Neverland?
Yeah.
That was so fictionalized that they should have just called it fiction, because, I mean, there's so many elements of that just aren't true. And I understand you have to fictionalize things sometimes. You know, it's one of those things. You have to fictionalize it, and, you know, because sometimes you have to make it more interesting or more palatable, or you got to combine a few people into one character because you can't have these, you know, disparate characters out there doing that. But to me, like when you go too far, like when you go so far to Hollywoodize something, then it's like, was that really even worth telling? You know, as a true story,
right?
Maybe just use it as an inspiration, you know, like inspired by a true story, and then you just create a fictional thing. I mean, that's fine, but like, you know, like, I mean, A League of Their Own is a good example of that. A League of Their Own took a very real thing, this formation of this girls' baseball league. I think the Rockford Peaches were a real team. I can't remember if they're a real team or not, but everybody on the team were fictional.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you knew they were fictional because then they kind of tell you that at the end. Glow, the TV series on Netflix, is another example. Glow really existed. There really was a the gorgeous ladies of wrestling. But, you know, and even though that a lot of these characters kind of emulate real people, it's not. It's fictional. Mm-hmm. You know, everything about it is fictional, and that's fine. It creates, you know, Orange is the New Black, based on real people, based on real experience, but very fictional, and it's clear that it's fictional. And I think that, you know, that if we're going to draw those lines, we need to make clear that there are lines there, that this is really what happened and this isn't.
No, I agree. And the fact that American Beauty has, I think the fact that these are fictional characters gives them more free rein in a way to play it more real, because when you have something that's based on real events or based on real people, at least, I think it gets, you know, everybody wants to have their say. For example, with Green Book, the real Tony Lip, his like son, I think, is one of the co-writers of the movie. So it's not, yeah, we're kind of to be very objective. Or like, you know, Bohemian Rhapsody, which is another one that I like to mention a lot lately, that plays very fast and loose with the timeline of Freddie Mercury's life because, well, Roger Taylor and Brian May are involved in the production of the film. So they're telling their version of the story, focusing on them and like shifting things around to make it, again, like you said, more Hollywoodized. So
yeah, very unrealistic. I mean, and, you know, and that's a good example. Bohemian Rhapsody, even though I have not seen it yet, you know, but from what I've read in certain reviews of it, the, you know, with Bohemian Rhapsody is that, you know, I mean, and my issue is with the relationship that, you know, that Freddie Mercury has, you know, with his, you know, which person who become his partner mm-hmm. up until his death, that the way that they showed how they got together, you know, not only is it not accurate, it's totally silly. And it creates like this false impression about how, you know, how gay relationships work, right. You know, that you just show up at somebody's door and say, hey, you're my boyfriend now, and, you know. And then you walk off and you tell them, hey, look, it's pretty my much. Boyfriend. It's, that's not how that works. Right. And I mean, and to me, that's just, that's silly. And I think that that's actually degrading to Freddie Mercury's memory.
Yeah, I think that's definitely true. But bringing it back to American Beauty, like what do you think, you know?
I know, I tangent off, sorry.
It's okay. Hey, that's all. We're all about tangents here. You know, what do you, you know, we're going to talk about Kevin Spacey's performance and set aside his real life issues and all of that. So what do you think about his performance that makes it so so memorable, so powerful, so Academy Award worthy?
Well, I mean, I think the fact that he plays it so that you know, to me, the best actors are the kind, especially the big named actors, are the kind that you forget who they are. Mm-hmm. That, you know, that you don't see that, you know, and that's one reason why I can still watch. I watched American Beauty again probably a few weeks ago with my, you know, with my better half. And, you know, that was his first time seeing it ever. And, you know, and it was a very interesting experience for him as well. And, you know, like for him, he sees Kevin Spacey as the person who, you know, attacked, you know, Anthony Rapp, basically, when mm-hmm. Anthony Rapp was a teenager and all the stuff that's happening with that. But here you totally forget that that's who that is. You know, the best actors are the kind that even without makeup or the help of prosthetics or anything, that you totally forget who they are. And you know, Kathy Bates is another one of those examples for me, where Kathy Bates, you know, her look, her feel, everything about her is so Kathy Bates-like until she takes on a character, and then you totally forget it's Kathy Bates. Because mm-hmm. she's so brilliant at doing that. And I think that – because what they do is they create these characters, and the characters seem so full and so real. Like they have like this whole complete story behind them, even though we don't know what that story is, but it feels like it exists. And for Lester Burnham, I really feel like that is Lester Burnham. That is somebody who, you know, that we just kind of picked up, you know, in the middle of him jerking off in the shower, and that's where we get started. And you know, we pick up his life from there until when it ends. And I think that's what makes a difference for that.
And it's interesting too, because I feel like his character undergoes a pretty radical transformation from the beginning of the movie being this sort of pathetic sad sack, like running out to the car and all his briefcase opens up and papers going everywhere. He's very like kind of almost like laughably bumbling at the beginning, and then yeah. And then he becomes really empowered throughout the course of the film, which I think, you know, is a testament to the fact that he has all this pent up hostility and that he's really been biting his tongue with his wife for however many years this dynamic has been this bad. And it also opens up a lot of the thing that's funny about this film is that it's heavy, but it's very obviously a drama, but it's also elements of dark comedy, and they come out of sort of the bizarre thrill of kind of seeing his like breakthrough / breakdown, you know, over the course of the film, whether it's like his midlife crisis manifesting in his sexual attraction for his daughter's friend, or buying an expensive like sports car, and starting to work out. And I think it all feels grounded in that he's just looking for a sense of validation, like something to break him out of this basically this world that he feels trapped in.
And you know, and the visual and you know, and the direction of this, you know, and everything else also helps with that growth, with that change in Lester Burnham, because you know, if you see him at the beginning of the film, we see him from a distance. And if we don't see him from a distance in the beginning, if we see him up close, we'll see him like with something else. Like for instance, like we see him like where we see his reflection in the computer screen, and the computer screen has like these columns of text which look like jail bars. So we see his reflection, which looks like he's in prison. When he's first talking to the guy, the guy that was looking to get rid of somebody, the efficiency guy. Mm-hmm. When you know Brad, when he's sitting in the office with Brad, when you first see Kevin Spacey in that scene, he is so tiny. It looks like the camera is pretty much up at the Hubble Space Telescope.
Yeah, I know,
you know, so. Shooting him. He looks so small, but as he grows his balls, basically as he turns, you notice he gets bigger and bigger and bigger. That confidence shows that he's growing bigger and bigger. And I think that, you know, the other visual aspects of this too, which kind of show like kind of the dread that's there, even though like we think that it doesn't exist, is the use of red in this film. And I think that if you notice, everything in this film is muted except for the reds.
Mm-hmm.
So like if you see the dinner scene,
the flower petals, the red roses,
they're so bright compared to everything else, which kind of showing that, sure, you could put a, you know, like a bowl of roses on a table, but that doesn't mean everything is great on the inside.
Right. And it makes sense too, because the roses are really kind of his visual fantasy of Angela, and that really becomes his kind of the catalyst for his awakening. So it's almost like a smaller, more intimate version of like Pleasantville, where like, oh, there's a little bit of color in my life for the first
yeah.
time. And it's
Pleasantville's a great movie.
That's
too.
A great movie too, actually. Yeah, I haven't seen that in a long time. And that was also 1999, I think too. That's what I'm saying.
It yep, was like, I think so.
Outstanding year for movies. But that's really, you know, what starts to open up his perspective, and give him some kind of motivation to change his life. I mean, obviously, you know, what's complicating about that is that it's, you know, we're watching the film, we're sort of happy that he's kind of, I guess, looking to improve himself, even though his motivation is ultimately something kind of icky. So what do you feel about the fact that, you know, the Angela Lester subplot, as well as kind of, I mean, even with Ricky and Jane, like it basically starts out kind of quasi stalking her, and then that becomes a romance. How do you feel about the way that like these sort of ultimately questionable dynamics evolve over the course of the movie? I guess it really does kind of underscore the whole appearance/reality thing, in that things seem to be one way, but they're actually the other.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and the thing is about some of these, especially the relationship between Lester and Angela, you know, and how that develops. I remember my little sister who used to like to take my movie suggestions, but I think that some of the stuff that I like, you know, she's like, "What the hell?" you know, kind of thing. But she watched American Beauty based on my suggestion, and I don't know if she's ever gotten past the scene where he almost sleeps with Angela. And like she just stops. She just can't seem to get past that, because, you know, and that's the problem sometimes. If you know, you want to be provocative in a way, but you want to be, you know, to help highlight aspects of a story. But sometimes, you know, for some people, it just might be too much, and for whatever reasons. And, you know, and there are a lot of things that are difficult to watch. I mean, there's a lot of films that I see that I've only ever seen once, mm-hmm. even though I love them, but only because it's too difficult to see it again. And, you know, because sometimes it hits too close to home, or it's something so disturbing that it's just I can't go through that again. You know, and it's tough. I mean, what is 6 Degrees of Kevin Spacey? There was a Kevin Spacey film back in the late 90s where he and some other people, they were like guards in a children's detention center. And, you know, and these kids from the city, I think from Hell's Kitchen, like got in some trouble and ended up there, and they ended up like getting abused while they were there.
Are you talking about Sleepers?
Yeah, I think it's Sleepers.
Yeah.
I think it's what it's called. I think it's Sleepwalkers, and I knew that wasn't right. So I think Sleepers is right. And, you know, and I've only seen that movie once. I love that movie, but, you know, but the whole point, you know, the parts of the abuse and stuff, you know, it's so, I don't know, at least back then I was a lot younger. Maybe I'm a little bit more jaded now. And so, you know, but that's hard to watch, you know, that for me is just, that's very difficult to see. And, you know, and to know that those characters, it helps, you know, serve as motivation, even though, I mean, they shouldn't do what they did, you know, which is, you know, killing somebody and then, you know, using all the resources to get away with it. But at least to me, that does at least provide justification for it. And that's why it has to be that disturbing. I mean, and the audience has to understand that justification.
Well, sometimes you need to go that far with it to really make an impact on your viewer. And I think with something like American Beauty, it is really bleak. It is very uncompromising. There's, as we were, you know, the dark comedy I was mentioning with Lester, that's pretty much the only levity you get out of the film. And even then, it's kind of this like perverse, twisted version of comedy. We're kind of like living vicariously through this guy who just doesn't give a shit anymore. And is just kind of living life as he pleases, being like, wouldn't that be nice? But also in the context of all this other stuff going on. You know, and then I think a lot of times, I think people that talk about this movie, I think they forget about Annette Bening. And I think about, forget about her. Her performance, and she almost won an Oscar for this too. I can't remember who she lost to offhand.
I think she deserved. I think whoever won it did absolutely deserve it too. I mean, because I was thinking that was a tough year to win stuff, but Annette Bening is brilliant in this movie.
Yeah, she is. She's been consistently underrated as an actress. Like, I feel like every couple years she does a film that gets a lot of like critics praise and you know, gets a lot of smaller awards, but then when it comes to the Oscars, she like either gets nominated and loses to Hilary Swank. Oh, that's who won. There you go. Hilary Swank. She lost to Hilary Swank twice. or she doesn't get, now she falls just short of the you know, the top five best actresses that year. But her character could easily be sort of this just cliched, like nagging wife character. But I mean, the fact that the movie takes the time to delve into like why she feels so wound up, and her own, that she's not, like as she says in the film at one point, that Lester's not the only one that's sexually frustrated, and you know, she's under all this pressure on her own. You sort of like the film, I guess you get more of a thrill from watching Lester kind of let loose, I guess, but it doesn't really necessarily it doesn't really take sides either. You know, you understand where every character is coming from, as opposed to just, you know, putting Carolyn just straight into the villain category. And I think that's really a real strength of the movie, and, you know, Bening's performance.
And even like, and even though I think Chris Cooper's character is probably, if you're going to have a bad guy, that his is probably the bad guy. But ultimately, in a way, though, you also understand, you know, what he's going through. I mean, this is somebody who's so closeted, who's so ashamed. And, you know, and it comes back to that whole idea that the people who are usually the most homophobic, for instance, you know, are the ones that are probably the most gay, you know, that are probably the ones that are so afraid that everybody would know that they have to go to an extreme to show that they're not. Where the people who, you know, even if you sit there and you claim that they were and they're not, they don't care. It's like, I know what I am, then they definitely probably are what they are. But for him, you know, especially in the 90s, I think that a lot of times we forget about that historical context. You know, the 90s was not an easy time to come out. There were there's still a lot of, non-rights for the LGBT community now, even though it's a lot better than what it was. But, you know, back then it was definitely not better. You know, back then it was still very, I mean, this was only a few years after Philadelphia, you know, which was still considered groundbreaking. And now people watch that. It's like, oh, what's so groundbreaking about it? It's like, you should have watched it at the time when it came out. It was pretty groundbreaking. And, you know, and I think that those kind of things is that it's important to see that and, you know, but still understand their motivations. I think that movies that where you don't understand the motivations of the bad guys, where you have these two-dimensional, you know, antagonists, I think that it doesn't work. Like, if you don't understand why, you know, in the X-Men films, you know Magneto is supposed to be this bad guy, but you actually understand why, you know, that he basically has the same goal that Professor X has. He just has a different way of doing it. He doesn't think that the nice, you know, follow the rules way is the way that's going to achieve it. You know, he feels that you have to disrupt the system.
Right.
And, you know, and that's it. So it's basically the same goal, different approach. You know, he's not setting out to be bad. He just feels like in order to get attention, you kind of have to, you know, to protest in some way or disrupt in some way. And to me, those are the best villains. Those are the best any type of characters where you feel like they're justified in what they do. That's what creates that realism, is knowing that those justifications are there.
Well, and that's the thing. Real villains don't believe that they're doing anything villainous. They think that what they're doing is to go with a very 2018 example, Thanos thinks he's doing a good thing by snapping his fingers. He thinks he's saving the universe from kind of destroying itself. Just like in this film, Chris Cooper's character thinks that he's protecting his son from kind of, I guess, the self-loathing he feels, or like, you know, the judgment of the world or people like him. And it's much more complicated than just like, no, I'm just going, I'm oppressive and I just like to beat up my son. He believes he's doing the best. Like when he tells his son, you know, this is for your own good, he really believes that that's the case. You know, you make a good point about when this film came out in 99, 1989, that twist being sort of a still kind of a bold move for a major film to be hitting on that sort of repressed closeted homosexuality in that such a way, and have it kind of, you know, come out of nowhere necessarily, but, you know, for like straight people going to see this, like just going to see movies, the big Oscar movie of the season, maybe they weren't expecting that. And I think it maybe opened a lot of people's eyes to, oh, really, that's people, some kind of can process it that way, because a lot of people don't have that experience. And that's, you know, I think that's really part of what makes movies so interesting, is that you get to see other points of view. One I go to sometimes is something like Beasts of the Southern Wild, which was nominated for a few Oscars, less than a decade, like within the last few years. And that's about like this little girl and her father that live like in this like really run down area of like New Orleans that's like flooded and stuff. And it's like a perspective, a part of life that you would never see otherwise. And I think this definitely falls into that very gritty, very realistic, naturalistic slice of life film. And, you know, you get the viewpoints of all these different people on the same block who all have their own journeys and are all trying to figure themselves out in different ways.
And just touch a little bit too on the LGBT aspects of this. You know, we have to remember that in 1999, that gay depiction in mainstream films at this point was really just Philadelphia and anything then comical. I mean, you always had that comical, you know, you would probably think he's gay guy, or there were villains. I mean, you know, I love the talented Mr. Ripley, but Tom Ripley is the bad guy. Mm-hmm. You know, he's the one that's killing people and then trying to cover it up, you know, and creating this complex web because he fell in love with Jude Law. I mean, who wouldn't? And and all that stuff. But, you know, so either they were villains or they were comedy. Like, I mean, Will and Grace had been on the air for about a year at this point, but that was, once again, people could stomach it because it was funny. You know, because you can poke fun at it, which is okay, which helped open up those doors. Don't get me wrong. I have nothing against Will and Grace at all. I love that show. But, you know, but the thing is that to have these very serious, I mean, this is before Brokeback Mountain. This is before, you know, a lot of the films that kind of helped open those doors that I think helped lead to better equality. And, you know, and it was risky. You could really risk a huge backlash. And to me, if this had been more of a mainstream film, it probably would have received the backlash. You know, but luckily it's too smart, I think, for people who have those ideals to want to watch or to get through. So they probably didn't know anyway.
Yeah. I think, you know, just it's interesting too, because in an earlier episode of this podcast, Kai and I talked about Ace Ventura: Pet Detective, which is a movie that I really love because I grew up watching it, but has not aged well at all in regards to, you know, the gay community, or especially the end is like super transphobic. I mean, the whole big twist at the end is like, what? This woman was a man the whole time? And and it's played for laughs. They play the music from The Crying Game and everything. It's like, wow. So I think that's a part of what makes doing this show so interesting, is going back and watching these older films with sort of a, you know, respect for the artistry of the film and then the context in which it was released, but also kind of putting it through a modern context. And, you know, I think the fact that this film still feels so fresh and so progressive, it's probably of the last couple of decades, probably one of the best picture winners that has aged the best. Because a lot of them are not, you know, Hollywood has a tendency of being very dated with its social politics and things like that.
And I think, rightfully so. I mean, they have to play to the audience of the time, and, you know, which is sad sometimes, but it's nice when you get movies like this, which kind of throws that out the window a little bit and caters to the audience that it should be.
Yeah, I think so. We haven't really talked too much about Ricky and Jane, so I figured like we should probably talk about their storyline before we start wrapping up. So Thora Birch and Wes Bentley in this movie, and it's weird for me still watching this movie with Thora Birch, because I still see her as the little girl from Hocus Pocus, and then this is so far from that. It's only 6 years later.
But much
like, here she goes like, it's like a topless scene. She's just like totally emo.
She's actually underage in that scene too, by the way.
Is she really? So.
I think she's only 17, which, I mean, you can do that with parental, with parental permission. So,
I guess it's not 100% in a sexual context. I mean, it's just she's kind of just flashing him while, like, if it was in the middle of a sex scene, I think that would be kind of almost considered child pornography. Yeah. So, what did you, you know, how do you feel about their storyline? To me, I think it's the one. It's kind of the least compelling of the three Burnham family members, but I think it, you know. And it's also probably the one that's sort of poked fun at the most, the fact that Wes Bentley's whole thing with, you know, the videotape and the most beautiful thing I've ever seen, the plastic bag.
Yeah, the flying bag, yeah. Plastic bag. But, you know, the plastic bag thing, yes, it does get that, you know, probably the one thing, if people are familiar with American Beauty nowadays who maybe, you know, weren't paying attention or weren't even around back then, would probably know the spoofing of the plastic bag. And that's an easy thing to spoof. And but, you know, the thing was that he was trying to show is that, you know, it's once again, it goes back to that theme of looking closer. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's where you might not see, you know, where we might just say, oh, it's just a bag floating in the wind. No, look closer and you see the beauty of it dancing. You know, it looks like it's dancing.
Right.
You know, if you look really close to it. And I like that, you know, that this relationship was interesting, maybe not as much from Jane's side, mm-hmm. but, you know, because Jane, I think, had some other interesting aspects to her that, you know, especially with her relationship with her parents and her relationship with Angela. But I think this is better for Ricky's side. I think that Ricky, you know, showing that, you know what, I came out of the mental institution, wherever else that his father had sent him, and I came back and I'm a new person where, you know, I know what I want. And I'm going to go for what I want, and I'm going to fight for what I want, no matter what the risks are to it. You know, I'm going to, you know, I really want to be with Jane, and I'm going to show my love and appreciation, or maybe almost a little bit creepy. You know, I think lighting your name on fire in the lawn,
that
probably
was
a little too
was a step too far. Yeah.
Maybe don't do that. But I mean, but the thing is that he's, you know, and videotaping through the window and things like that. It's creepy. Yes. But at this, you know, and I'm not suggesting anybody ever do that. I don't think that's a healthy way of pursuing somebody. But he made it clear that that's what he wanted, and that he was confident that, you know, that if he wanted that, that she would say yes or she would say no. And if she said no, it wouldn't end his life.
Right. And he'd then move on to. He has that scene with her at school where she's like, stop obsessing over me. He's like, I'm not obsessing. I'm just curious. And it's like, you know, it feels like everybody in this film is just striving to be better, striving to be something that they're not, or like at odds with themselves. I mean, and Mina Suvari's Angela has that line at one point that she's like, there's nothing worse in life than being ordinary. That just, I had to write that down because I thought it was, you know, it really feels like the mission statement of this movie in a lot of ways, that this just feels like another house, another family in another neighborhood in another average American city. And they've all sort of settled for what they think their roles are rather than pushing themselves to, you know, to pursue who they really want to be. And I think Ricky's sort of off kilter way of looking at things really, really kind of brings that, brings that theme across the finish line. I mean, right. But at the end, you know, they walk in to see Lester's body, and instead of screaming or freaking out, he just kind of looks closer and notices that he was happy in that moment, and that, mm-hmm. you know, that he was at peace when it happened. And, you know, I think that really sets him apart from pretty much all the other characters in that regard. I do think that their storyline does feel like it develops Ricky way more than it develops Jane. He's the one that has the agency in the end to be like, if I go to New York, will you come with me? She's like, sure. That's her agency. Sure, I'll go along with you.
Yeah, but remember that development only. I think you mean that development only in terms of that relationship with Ricky, not her overall development. Because I thought she was pretty well developed, and I think in that respect, that was a kind of way of linking the two families together.
Right, in the context. You know,
and so maybe it wasn't the strongest, but at least it was a bridge between the two.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, I meant more in the context of that relationship, and he's really the one that kind of pushes it forward. I mean, he's the one with the camera, he's the one that kind of initiates that romance. Following the footsteps of Lester's life flashing before his eyes and kind of wrapping things up, what are sort of your final thoughts just on the film as a whole, and what would you say to people that haven't seen it to recommend it to them?
I think that if somebody wants something different from the usual formula that Hollywood gives us, that American Beauty is exactly what they need to see. That it has to be something provocative. That it has to be something thought-provoking. I mean, if you're a dumb person, this is not the film for you. You know, this is something that, you know, it's not escapism either. This is something that where, you know, you're watching it and you're really thinking about it, you know, through the movie, you're thinking about it after the movie, you're thinking about it 20 years after the movie. You know, it still crosses my mind every once in a while. And I think it's one of those that really hits you at home. And to me, it's by far one of the most perfect. It you know, I don't know if anything ever in life is perfect, but to me, American Beauty is probably what comes the closest. I used to change my mental list of my favorite movies of all time almost on a monthly basis, almost on a yearly basis. This movie has sat at the top of that for 20 years.
Wow.
And then nothing has been able to budget. And I've loved a lot of good movies. And there's been movies that have been, you know, that have been up there, but nowhere near it. I mean, and just watching it again recently, just it was the first time I watched it probably in like maybe 6 or 7 years. You know, I thought, well, you know what, this might bring it down then. I was afraid to watch it, I was afraid to bring it down because sometimes movies don't time very well. You know, they don't, you know, age very well. Mm-hmm. But no, it's still there.
Yeah, I mean, this is only the second time that, like I said, this is only the second time I've seen it. And I mean, I have to, it's, I don't know if it's, like you said, I don't know if perfection is ever really a thing, but it's definitely really close up there. And, you know, if I had to give it a rating, it's probably like a 4.5 out of 5 at least. And this is on my second viewing. But, you know, that the part of what makes the movies so rewarding is that everybody sees something different and that everybody gets something, and what resonates, what hits you a certain way might resonate stronger with you than it does with me, or vice versa. But I mean, I think universally, this is objectively a great movie, and it's definitely one that I would recommend that people check out if they haven't already seen it.
All our perspectives and experiences are different. So,
right.
You know, obviously, like for me, like I keep talking about, you know, some of the gay context in it, but that's because I'm gay. You know, that's part of my thing. Where you know, you're going to take something different out of that. You're going to go in and, you know, and you might even be more focused on the family aspect of it because, you know, you have a family.
I have a wife and child. Yeah. And actually, it's funny because Kai sat with me when I was watching this earlier today, and I was telling her, I'm like, hey, at least we're not that bad. Things like that. Let's not let that become us. It's sort of a kind of a cautionary tale in a way. It's like, hey,
I don't think Kai would ever allow that to happen.
No, I don't think so either. So I guess sort of wrapping up, like, Mike, where can people find you online, find more of your work?
You know, probably the best way to find me, even though I'm not really, I mean, I'm a Facebook person, but not really a social media person so much. But if you look up Alpha Waves Radio, you know, it's on Facebook, it's on Twitter, it's on Instagram. You know, those are good ways of finding me. And those usually help give you other avenues to find me as well if you really want to look for me. You know, I do encourage people to kind of join us on our Patreon page. I think we all have those now. But it really helps, you know, keep these shows going. Like, you know, just like Crooked Table, just like Alpha Waves Radio, this takes time and energy and resources that cost money, or, you know, or time and such, or takes us away from things that could make us money. So, you know, it's a way of at least showing some support, you know, by just showing a few dollars. So there, that's at patreon.com/alphawavesradio. And, you know, and those are probably the best places that you can find me.
Great. Yeah. I mean, yeah, as you mentioned, this is really a labor of love, and this is sort of us following our passions with Alpha Waves and Crooked Table. And so, you know, I appreciate anyone that wants to donate either to your Patreon or to Crooked Tables, because it means a lot to us to be able to do this, and to get any kind of monetary compensation is very much appreciated. So in that regard, Mike, thanks so much. I really appreciate you sharing your passion for American Beauty with me and our listeners. And I'll definitely have to have you on the Crooked Table podcast again someday soon.
I hope so. Maybe in another 7 years you'll bring me on. So it's like our Pond Far.
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
If you're interested in joining me on the show to chat about one of your favorite films, head on over to crookedtable.com/guest. Or you can consider supporting the show at patreon.com/crookedtable. Of course, you can always find more podcasts, reviews, videos, and other movie-related goodies over at crookedtable.com. Until next time, this has been the Crooked Table Podcast, and I've been Rob.
This has been a production of crookedtable.com. All rights reserved.
That's the R-O-O-K-E-D.